first scripture reading for this Sunday comes from Matthew chapter 10, verses 24 through 39. Hear now the word of the Lord. A disciple is not above the teacher, nor a slave above the master. It is enough for the disciple to be like the teacher and the slave like the master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them. For nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. What I say to you in the dark, tell in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim from the housetops. Do not fear those who kill the body, but it cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. And even the hairs of your head are all counted. So do not be afraid. You are of more value than many sparrows. Everyone, therefore, who acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I will also deny before my Father in heaven. Jesus continues, "Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law, and one's foes will be members of one's own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever does not take up the cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Those who find their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second scripture reading comes from Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 11. Hear now the word of the Lord. What then are we to say? Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For we have been united with him in a death like his. We will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you must also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this scripture conversation for Sunday, June 21st. It is a joy once again to be gathering virtually with you all. I hope your summer is off to a great start as school at last is out and you can enjoy your time playing and learning in a different way. I wanted to talk today with y'all about bullies. For many adults, if you ask them if they remembered an instance in their childhood when they were bullied themselves or when they participated in bullying, most adults would be able to come up with a story pretty quickly. Bullies are often driven by fear. They're afraid of being picked on themselves, and so they're quick to pick on others. Bullying comes in many forms. A bully might be picking on another person, or a bully might be mean, or a bully might make you yourself live in fear. Christ calls us to stand up to bullies. Christ calls us to live not in fear, but in love. In our gospel reading for today, Jesus is sending out the original 12 disciples to go and share his good news with the world. And when Christ is giving them his instructions to go out and to help others and to care for others and to love others, Christ is real with them. Christ tells them that it's going to be hard, that they will meet with folks who don't like what they're doing. They're going to meet folks who want things to stay the way they are. And they're going to ultimately meet bullies who are going to pressure them, who are going to try to make them stay silent. But Christ emphasizes to the disciples, do not fear. He says, do not be afraid. Live your life guided by love because God is with you. There are going to be moments in our lives when we're going to find ourselves making tough choices, when we are being picked on or we see others being picked on. And those are the moments when Christ calls us, like those original disciples, to be a part of his mission of love. Christ calls us to pray for our enemies. Christ calls us to be honest, to remind one another that we are called to love each other. Even in the midst of difference, even in the midst of disagreements, Christ reminds his disciples to be guided by God's love. So as we look ahead to the summer, as we look ahead to the folks that we're going to be playing with, whether it's our siblings or friends down the street, this is an important time to remember Christ's call to love. It's a tough call. It's not an easy one, but Christ reminds us that God is with us and that God loves us very much. So as you go out into your summer, may you hear Christ's call to love, to stand up to those who are being mean, and to remind others that we are called to love, to care, to sit with those who are being left out, to go above and beyond in how we interact, how we relate, how we care for each other. So may you be inspired. May Christ's words give you hope this day. Amen. Amen. Good morning and welcome back to worship on this Sunday, June 21st. This is our third and final sermon on the theme, Presby What? Over the weeks, we have been exploring what Presbyterians believe about God, what Presbyterians believe about God and relationship with us, and what Presbyterians believe about our relationships with each other. So this Sunday, we are exploring the theme of we are family, the ways that Christ changes our relationship to one another. This weekend, the General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church has begun meeting. It's a strange year as the General Assembly is meeting virtually. Originally planned to gather in Baltimore over about a week and a half, all of the gathering has been moved online for conversation and discernment. One of the ways that the Presbyterian Church reflects how Christ changes our relationship to one another is how we organize ourselves, how we have organized our governance to reflect Christ's grace and Christ's compassion. As a denomination, we are organized in a representational way. At each level of the church, there are folks who gather to discern how we move forward together, whether it's the session at our local church, whether it's the presbytery, which is the regional gathering of many churches, whether it's the synod, which is the next level of church organization, or whether it's at the national level. Any time that Presbyterians gather together, there's always equal representation of elders and pastors. There's always the goal of a diverse representation across race, gender, and other categories. And there's also a commitment that when we gather together to make decisions, we are guided by the Holy Spirit, discerning together, debating together, regardless of what the issue is, whether it's a matter of budget or of policy or of practice. As a Presbyterian church, we name that relationships are tough. That even in our baptisms, as we have been organized into a new community in Christ, nevertheless, sin and death are still present. And so often we fall short of God's beloved community. Perhaps you've been feeling, especially recently, how tough it has been to be in relationship during these times. It makes a big difference to gather face to face for honest conversation. In these times when the pandemic has raised our attention, in these times when important national events are happening, it's become clearer and clearer, at least to me, that so much of the work of the Holy Spirit, so much of the movement of interrelationship conversation is best done in person. When we gather via the internet, when we gather with screens in front of us, it's harder to be fully honest, it's harder to listen, it's harder to connect in ways. And it's so important, again, these moments as a church, to name that we are called, even in our times of disagreement, to have conversations and to be present with one another, to honestly listen and to have empathy. For when Christ sends his disciples, when Christ gives essentially his commissioning to them in Matthew chapter 10, he is honest with them. He's honestly blunt even at some points. He says directly to them that I am sending you out like sheep into the wolves. Christ names that in this commissioning of his disciples, it's not going to be a perfect journey. It's not going to be a slam dunk. It's not going to be all roses. It's not going to be easy. Christ emphasizes that the gospel calls us all, that the gospel, just as it called the original disciples, calls us today to have tough conversations, to stand up to others, and to experience rejection and disagreement. Jesus emphasizes that in these times, he has come not to bring peace, but the sword. He names that there the gospel may cause family splits, to turn father against son and son against father, to turn mother against daughter and vice versa. It's an interesting text to have on Father's Day, but it's one nevertheless. It's an invitation to hear what Jesus and how Jesus is calling us to discipleship. For ultimately for Christ, discipleship means taking risks. Discipleship means risking conflict. Disciple means even risking one's own life to stand up for others, to stand up for God, as Christ himself witnessed through his life, through his death, through his resurrection. Discipleship means standing up even at risk to one's own safety, one's own self. Discipleship also calls us in different ways. In setting up an honest and even grim presentation of his mission for the disciples, Jesus says over and over, "Do not fear. Do not be afraid." Jesus gets serious that even as we assess the risks, honestly, of our call to discipleship, we are called to base who we are and who we are called to be in love. We are not called to give in to fear, to be motivated by fear, to be reactionary towards fear. Rather, Christ calls us. Christ calls us to be grounded in empathy, to be grounded in compassion, to be grounded in our dependence on God. So one exercise that I love, I learned this during a seminary class. I'll call it the paper exercise. So I'm gonna hold up a piece of paper and I want you to say out loud, wherever you are, what color you see this paper as. So what color do you see this paper as? Say it out loud. So I see this paper as green. What color do you see it as? All right, let me hold up this paper again. What color do you see it as now? Say it out loud. So I see this paper color as blue. So this is not a magic trick. I did not change the color of the paper. Rather, one side of the paper is green and the other is blue. These are the moments, again, in our biblical exploration, in our theological exploration of who God is, that perspective makes a difference. For when I hold the paper like this, you have one perspective and I have another. But say we were to shift our perspectives through empathy, through vulnerability, through standing side by side one another, suddenly we understand how when we look at the paper on this side versus this side, we see different colors. And we can understand how when we were disagreeing about the colors, it came from our different perspectives. This exercise emphasizes the value of empathy, the value of compassion, the value of vulnerability, of being willing to say, what I see as green or what I see as blue is my perspective, but allowing for others' perspectives to be true as well. And through empathy, through compassion, to be able to begin to shift, to take steps, to see the world, to see a piece of paper from another's perspective. These are gospel moments of recognizing that in our world, ultimately, these values of the gospel, of empathy, of compassion, of love and care, can often run head to head with the values of the world. For example, when Christ emphasizes the importance of vulnerability, of standing with those who are on the margins, this comes into opposition with our values of the world, especially the value of rightness, of being correct, of not being vulnerable to correction. Vulnerability means that we are open to change. In addition, Christ's values of generosity, Christ's values of caring for people over profits, often stands in opposition to our world. And yet Christ calls us to that place of risk-taking. In our baptisms and in our mission, Christ calls his disciples to live dependently on God, to live vulnerably, and to live in new relationship. In Christ's teachings, he emphasizes that we are called to pray for one's enemies, and we are called to stand up to our families. This is so counter to the Roman culture. This is so counter to the Roman system of family hierarchy. And when we're honest, this is counter to our own modern culture as well. To pray for our enemies, to stand up to one's family, this seems like the world upside down. And yet, Christ calls us to a different way. When we would be inclined to dig our heels in, when we would be afraid of being wrong, when we would value a negative peace. A negative peace, as Martin Luther King described, is a peace built on injustice. A negative peace is one where it seems like the world is right, and yet below the surface there is so much that is wrong. We are called to a positive peace, a peace that is not afraid of tension, a peace that is not afraid of honesty that brings disagreement. But Christ emphasizes that in our baptisms, we are family. We have been baptized through Christ into the family of God. We are named as children of God, and we are named as siblings to one another. This is what Paul speaks about in Romans. We are called to a resurrection life, a life of new relationships with one another, a life not built on fear, but built on hope, a life built on new life in Christ. I was reading a book on by Parker Palmer last week that reflected on wholeness, on the wholeness of adults, where as children we often have a hidden inner self, but as adults we begin to hide that self from the world, and we begin to have an inner self and an outer self. And Parker, in his writings, reflects especially as Christians, we are called to wrestle with our inner and outer self so that they are in conversation with one another. He writes that we can survive, even thrive, amid the complexities of adulthoods by deepening our awareness of the endless inner and outer exchanges that shapes us and our worlds. So often we are driven by fear to hide what we believe and hold on to what we believe only on the inside, and to not live an outer self that reflects our values. But Christ calls us to a mission that connects our inner and outer self. Christ calls us to not hide our values, but rather to live them out in relationship with each other. I particularly liked the image that Parker Palmer used of a Mobius strip. I'm going to use this paper prop again. So this blue perhaps represents our inner self, and this green reflects our outer self. For Parker Palmer, he talks that for wholeness as an adult, it takes creating a Mobius strip of our inner and outer self. So let me explain.
So if we hear Christ's call to discipleship, a call to generosity, a call to vulnerability, a call to not live in fear, that's perhaps represented by our blue self. And yet our outer self, as we live in the world, we are met with the realities of businesses driven by profit, by our workplace requirements. And this Mobius strip for Parker represents our constant struggle to reconcile what we believe with the realities of the world. And I think this Mobius strip represents Christ's calling. Christ doesn't believe it's going to be easy to take what we believe and implement it out into the world. Rather, we're called to this Mobius strip of faith. So again, it can never become a full circle. It's always twisting and turning unto itself. But we're called to take our inner values and put them into conversation with the outer world, to take that conversation of the outer world and integrate it into our inner values. This, I believe, is the resurrection life, a life of complexities, a life of inner and outer struggling, inner struggling with ourselves and who we're called to be, and an outer struggling with relationships with others, how we're called to be in right relationship with God and with our neighbors. Christ calls us to take up the cross, to live a life of resurrection together. But the gift of this calling is that these Mobius strips don't exist alone. Each one of them is in company with other disciples, for Christ sends the original 12 out into the world together. So we are sent as Newcastle Presbyterian Church. So we are sent as the Presbyterian Church USA. And so we are sent as the whole church around the world, siblings in Christ, the new family of God, called to wrestle together with Christ's call to discipleship, with Christ's call to risk, with Christ's call to tension, with Christ's call to resurrection. May you go with God this day. Vaya con Dios. Amen.